to where? Okay.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. In the name of Allah, the All-Merciful, the All-Compassionate. Fatimatu Zahra, the daughter of the Prophet, peace be upon them, is to have thus related an event. My father, the Prophet of Allah, came to my house one day and said to me, "Peace be on you, Fatima." I replied, "And upon you be peace." Then he said, "I feel weakness in my body." I said, "Allah protects you from weakness, father." He said, "Fatima, please bring the Yemeni cloak to cover me with it." So I brought the Yemeni cloak and covered him with it. Then I looked at him and saw the face was shining like a full moon with its glory and splendor. After a while, my son Hassan came in and said, "Peace be on you, mother." I replied, "And upon you peace, O light of my eyes and the heart of my and the delight of my heart." He then said, "Mother, I smell a fragrance so sweet and so pure as that of my grandfather, the Prophet of Allah." I replied, "Yes, your grandfather is lying underneath the cloak." Hassan went near the cloak and said, "Peace be on you, my grandfather, and the Prophet of Allah. May I enter the cloak with you?" He replied, "And upon you peace, my son and the master of the fountain, Kothar. You are given the permission to enter." So Hassan entered the cloak with him. After a while, my son Hussein came in and said, "Peace be on you, mother." I replied, "And upon you peace, O light of my eyes and the delight of my heart." He then said, "Mother, I smell a sweet fragrance like that of my grandfather, the Prophet of Allah." I replied, "Yes, your grandfather and your brother are lying underneath the cloak." Hussein stepped towards the cloak and said, "Peace be on you, my grandfather, the chosen of Allah. May I enter the cloak with you?" He replied, "And upon you peace, my son and the interceder of my followers. You are given the permission to enter." So Hussein entered the cloak with them. After a while, Abu Hassan, Ali ibn Abi Talib, came in and said, "Peace be on you, O daughter of the Prophet of Allah." I replied, "And upon you peace, O father of Hassan and the commander of the faithful." He then said, "Fatima, I smell a sweet fragrance like that of my brother, my cousin, and the Prophet of Allah." I replied, "Yes, he is underneath the cloak with your two sons." So Ali went near the cloak and said, "Peace be on you, Prophet of Allah. May I enter the cloak with you?" He replied, "And upon you peace, my brother, my legatee, my successor, and my standard bearer. You are given the permission to enter." So Ali entered the cloak with them. Then I stepped forward and said, "Peace be on you, my father, O Prophet of Allah. May I enter the cloak with you?" He replied, "And upon you peace, my daughter. O part of myself, you are given the permission to enter." So I entered the cloak with them. Getting together underneath the cloak, my father and the Prophet of Allah held the two ends of the cloak and raised the right hand towards the heavens and prayed, "O Allah, these are the people of my household, Ahlul Bayt. They are the confidence and my supporters. Their flesh is my flesh, and their blood is my blood. Whoever hurts them hurts me too. Whoever displeases them displeases me too. I am at war with those at war with them. I am at peace with those at peace with them. I am the enemy of their enemies. I am the friend of their friends. They are from me, and I am from them. O Allah, bestow your blessings, benevolence, forgiveness, and your pleasure. Keep away and upon pleasure upon me and upon them, and keep away impurity from them, and keep them thoroughly pure. Then the Lord Almighty Allah says, O my angels, O residents of my heavens, verily, I have not created the erected sky, the stretched earth, the illuminated moon, the bright sun, and the rotating planets, the flowing seas, and the sailing ships, but for the love of these five lying under the cloak. Jibreel, the trusted angel, asked, Who are under the cloak? The Almighty answered, There are the household of the Prophet and the assets of prophethood. They are Fatima, her father, her husband, and her two sons. Jibreel said, O Lord, may I fly to earth to be the sixth of them? Allah replied, Yes, you are given the permission. Jibreel, the trusted, landed near them and said, Peace be on you, O Prophet of Allah. The All Highest conveys his peace on you and his greetings and says, By my honor and glory, O my angels, O residents of my heavens, verily, I have not created the erected sky, the stretched earth, the illuminated moon, the bright sun, and the rotating planets, the flowing seas, and the sailing ships. But for your love, God has given me permission to enter the cloak with you. May I join you, O Prophet of Allah? The Prophet replied, And peace be on you, O trusted bearer of Allah's revelations. You are granted the permission. So Jibreel entered the cloak with us and said to my father, Allah, send his revelations to you. Verily, Allah's desire is to keep away blemish from you, O people of household, Ahlul Bayt, and purify you with a perfect purification. Then Ali said to my father, O Prophet of Allah, tell me what significance has Allah given for getting together underneath this cloak? The Prophet replied, By him who rightfully appointed me a prophet and chose me a messenger for the salvation of this mankind. Whenever and wherever an assembly of our followers and friends mention this event, Allah will bestow on them his blessings and mercy. Angels will encircle them, asking Allah the remission of their sins until the assembly disperse. So Ali said, Verily, by the Lord of Kaaba, we and our followers are the winners. Then my father replied, By him who rightfully appointed me a prophet and chose me a messenger for the salvation of the mankind. Whenever and wherever an assembly of our followers and friends mention this event, there shall remain grief, but Allah will remove his grief. There shall remain none distress, but Allah will dispel his distress. There shall remain none wish seeker, but Allah will grant his wish. Ali happily said, Verily, by the Lord of Kaaba, we and our followers are the winners and the blessed, in this world and the next.
Please recite aloud, Salawat. At this time, I'd like to invite Brother Muhammad to recite a short poem, Salawat.
Assalamu alaikum, everyone. Today I'll be reading a poem called I Wish, written by me and not by ChatGPT. I want you to close your eyes and imagine. Imagine the calls of Al-Atash from the blessed children of Imam Hussein. Imagine all the soldiers of Yazid only thinking of gain. Imagine Bibi Zainab watching as everyone asks permission to ready for battle. Imagine Hazrat Abbas trying to fit Qasim on the saddle. Imagine her as free can be. Imagine Shimmer La'natullah and the truth he could not see. Imagine Bibi Sakina watching the standards of battle waver. Imagine Umme Rubab requesting water for Ali Asghar as a favor. Imagine Habib running at the call of his Imam. Imagine An and Muhammad, composed, young, and calm. Imagine Karbala, with bated breath, waiting for the men's return. Imagine Imam Sajjad, sick in his tent, hearing the tents burn. I wish I was there in Karbala. I wish I was alongside my Imam. I wish I could retrieve water for Bibi Sakina. I wish I could fight for Islam. I wish I could answer to that call of Hussein. I wish I could say, I am here for you, O Hussein. I wish I was there to help Umme Rubab retrieve water for her infant. I wish I was there to ride into battle like Hazrat Qasim. I wish I was there to prevent Yazid's army from burning the tents. I wish I could have told Yazid's army the truth. I wish I could have consoled the children from their shock. I wish I was there to stop all the arrows in prayer. I wish I was there to protect the ladies from the whips. I wish I was there to help Imam Sajjad walk. I wish. But I was not there on that day. But every day is Ashura and every land is Karbala. I can walk from Najaf to Karbala showing my loyalty. I can be with my Imam by thinking, understanding, and acting like him. I can be close to the Ahlul Bayt too. I can do good deeds and have strong faith. I can spread truth to people who do not know of the unique sacrifices that were made. I can make sure no hypocrite can try and ruin Hussein's message. I can show people the message of Hussein through my actions. I can be a true follower of Islam. I can pray for the return of our 12th Imam. Let us recite Dua Imam Zaman together and pray for his return. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Allahumma kun li waliyakal Hujjat ibn al-Hasan salawatuka alayhi wa ala ba'e fi hadhihi sa'a wa fi kulli sa'a waliyan wa hafidha وقائدا وناصرا ودليلا وعينا حتى تسكنه أرضك طوعا وتمتعه فيها طويلا برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين صلوات.
MashaAllah, please recite a loud salawat for Brother Muhammad. Just a couple of quick announcements. We kindly request everyone to please put their phones on mute. We kindly request everyone to just move up a little bit for proper majlis etiquette. And we also request everyone to please also on both sides to lower the noise levels. And without further ado, I'd like to invite Sayyid Al Khuzaini to the member with the loud salawat. Allahumma salli ala.
Sent. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على خير خلقه أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد، وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين، صلى الله عليك يا سيدي ويا مولاي يا أبا عبد الله، صلى الله عليك يا سيدي يا ابن رسول الله، يا رحمة الله الواسعة، ويا باب نجاة الأمة، ويا عبرة كل مؤمن ومؤمنة، يا ليتنا كنا معكم سادتي فنفوز فوزا عظيما. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ما آتاكم الرسول فخذوه وما نهاكم عنه فانتهوا. صلوا على محمد وآل محمد. Do the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi and the holy Imams have the right to legislate laws in the sense that can they make changes to the acts of worship? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if He ordained salah with special units, can they add? Can they subtract? Do they have such a wilaya? Do they have such an authority? Does Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi have this sort of authority to make certain things halal and to make other things haram, to make legislations and to introduce laws into Islam? Is this permissible? Does Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, along with the rest of the Imams, do they have this authority known as al-wilaya tashri'iyya? Al-wilaya tashri'iyya is the authority of legislating laws, making laws, introducing laws that have not been introduced by Allah Azza wa Jal. This is the key point. There are laws that are legislated by Allah and delivered by Rasulullah. This is not what we're talking about. We talked about this last night. We said that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi enjoys how many roles and positions? 6. We mentioned this yesterday. One of those roles is that he's a messenger of Allah. He delivers the divine commands, the fixed laws that were legislated by Allah. Tonight, we are talking about something else. Can Rasulullah fix his own laws, legislate his own laws? Not the laws of Allah, his own laws. And this is known as al-wilayah tashri'iyya. Is this possible or is this not possible? And we are also not talking about temporary laws or temporary measures that are issued by Rasulullah as a wali al-amr. We're not talking about hukum wilayati. which we mentioned yesterday. We said that as a commander-in-chief, as the head of state, Rasulullah can issue certain orders and commands known as ahkam wilayatiyya, and these are temporary measures. This is not what we're talking about. We're talking about fixed laws that are meant to stay till the day of judgment, but issued by Rasulullah and the imams and not Allah Azza wa Jal. And this is known as al-wilayat tashri'iyya, the authority to legislate laws. Does this exist or does this not exist? Some may argue that yes, al-wilayat tashri'iyya exists. What is proof of this wilayah? The following verses may be used as evidence for al-wilayat tashri'iyya. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Ma atakum ar-Rasulu fakhuduh. That which is ordered by Rasulullah, take it. وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُ. And that which he forbids you from doing, stop. The verse doesn't say مَا آتَاكُمُ اللَّهُ, what Allah orders you. No, مَا آتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ, what Rasulullah orders you. And what Rasulullah forbids you from doing, obey. So this is one verse. Another verse, النَّبِيُّ أَوْلَى بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ مِنْ أَنفُسِهِمْ. Rasulullah has priority and precedence over the mu'mineen from themselves. Meaning he can order, he can forbid. Another verse, إِنَّمَا وَلِيُّكُمُ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا الَّذِينَ يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ وَيُؤْتُونَ الزَّكَاةَ وَهُمْ رَاكِعُونَ. Allah is your guardian and so is Rasulullah and those who have authority amongst you. طيب, صلى على محمد وعلى محمد. Historically speaking, there was a group from the Shia, they claimed to be Shia, they were known as Al-Mufawwidha. And they were a sect of Ghulat. Ghulat are those who ascribe to the Ahlul Bayt, to the Imams, qualities that they did not claim to themselves. They claim that the Imams can create, can give rizq, can do things, and not with the permission of Allah. No. Saying that the Imams can do these things with the permission of Allah, this is not ghulu. But to say that Allah creates and the Imam also creates, they're like partners. Allah can create and the Imam can create. Not with the permission of Allah. This is called what? Ghulu. This is exceeding the limit in your belief in the Ahlul Bayt. Tayyib. As an offshoot of the Ghulat, there was a group called Al-Mufawwidha. Who are Al-Mufawwidha? Al-Mufawwidha believed that Allah created the Ahlul Bayt and then he designated everything to them. فَوَّضَ إِلَيْهِمْ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ. He told them that you may do whatever you want, I will not get involved. I will no longer get involved. You, the Ahlul Bayt, can perform anything you'd like. فَوَّضَ إِلَيْهِمْ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ. They can create, they can give life, they can take life. They can give rizq, they can take away rizq. And Allah sits back and doesn't do anything. This is called tafweed. And those who believe in this belief are called mufawwidha. And our ulama and even our imams, they cursed this group. They would call them al-mufawwidha la'anahum Allah. Because this belief, it's not kufr, but it is incorrect. It is incorrect to say that Allah created the Ahlul Bayt and then He left the world. He left everything up to them. Not just in creating, but even in setting laws. So Allah created the Ahlul Bayt and He left all the laws up to the Ahlul Bayt. This is called tafweed and this is wrong. This is not what we believe in. There was a group of ghulat that had this belief known as at-tafweed. As-Saduq and his books clearly states, al-mufawwidha la'anahum Allah. May Allah curse them. So to set the record straight, this tafweed in the way that I just described, this is rejected by our ulama. We, the imamis, ithna asharis, we reject this sort of belief. Wa sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. So let's come back to the question of, does the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, and the imams, do they have the authority to legislate laws? التشريع حق التشريع الولاية التشريعية. Do they have this or do they not have this? There are three theories. The first theory is that they do not. They do not have such authority and they do not have such a right. Those who accept the first theory, they argue based on certain verses of the Holy Quran. For example, وَمَا يَنْطَقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ. Rasulullah will never speak out of personal desire. Whatever he says, it's revelation of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Anything that he says, it's not from him. He's not legislating. He's not ordering. He's not forbidding. It's all from Allah. إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ. طيب. Another verse. وَلَوْ تَقَوَّلَ عَلَيْنَا بَعْضَ الْأَقَاوِيلِ لَأَخَذْنَا مِنْهُ باليمين ثم لقطعنا منه الوتين. If he says a word that we never said, that we will hold him by the right hand and we will cut off his veins. Meaning that Rasulullah does not say a single word by his own. Anything that he says is from Allah Azza wa Jal. Allah legislates, Rasulullah delivers, period. Full stop. طيب. Another verse, لَيْسَ لَكَ مِنَ الْأَمْرِ شَيْءٍ. Ya Rasulullah, you have no say in anything. لَيْسَ لَكَ مِنَ الْأَمْرِ شَيْءٍ. You have no say in anything. You are merely a deliverer. You deliver the message. You do not call the shots. We call the shots. You do not make any decisions. We make the decisions. We make the decisions. You only deliver. You deliver the message. Nothing is in your hands. لَيْسَ لَكَ مِنَ الْأَمْرِ شَيْءٍ. طيب. Another verse. شَرَعَ لَكُم مِنَ الدِّينِ مَا وَصَّى بِهِ نُوحًا. Allah is the one that legislates. شَرَعَ لَكُم. Who? Allah. Allah is the one that legislates laws. Not anyone else. No one else has this authority. No one shares this authority with Allah. Only Allah legislates laws. And another verse. إِنِ الْحُكْمُ إِلَّا لله. Allah is the judge. Allah is the ruler. Allah is the king. Allah is the legislator. Al-huk, part of it is legislation. إِنِ الْحُكْمُ إِلَّا لِلَّهِ. Only Allah decides. Only Allah legislates. So this is the first theory. This is regarding Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the same thing goes for the imams. In fact, if we say that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam does not have al-wilaya tashri'iyya, then it goes without saying that the imam also does not have al-wilaya tashri'iyya. If Rasulullah does not have the authority to legislate laws, then the imams, and it goes without saying that the imams also cannot legislate laws. In fact, there's a hadith by Imam Sadiq alayhi salam. He says, he says, hadithi, hadithu abi. What I'm telling you is not from my own. It's not from my own pocket. Hadithi, hadithu abi. My hadith is the hadith of my father. Wa hadithu abi, hadithu jaddi. And the hadith of my father is not from his own. It's from his father. Wa hadithu jaddi, hadithu Ali ibn al-Husayn. Or wa hadith. وحديث جدي حديث الحسين وحديث الحسين حديث الحسن وحديث الحسن حديث أمير المؤمنين وحديث أمير المؤمنين حديث رسول الله وحديث رسول الله قول الله عز وجل. You see, there's a link. The Imam is saying, I don't say anything from my own. What I said, I learned from Imam al-Baqir. And what Imam al-Baqir said, he learned from Ali ibn al-Husayn. And what Ali ibn al-Husayn learned, he took it from Imam al-Husayn. From Imam al-Husayn to Imam al-Hasan to Amir al-Mu'mineen to Rasulullah to Allah Azza wa Jal. None of it is from our own. None of it is from our own pocket. We're not legislating. It is all from Allah Azza wa Jal. This is the first theory. The second theory, Sallallahu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. The second theory, and this is held by a great deal of ulama, and this is the theory that we support and we hold, is that the Prophet and the Imams did have the right to legislate. They did have the right. They have al-wilaya tashri'iyya. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this was not given given to them on the street. This authority they received from Allah Azza wa Jal. They received the authority from Allah. Allah gave them the right to legislate. However, it was a limited authority. It was not a full-on authority. It was a limited authority. So the major legislations were made by Allah Azza wa Jal. Salah, Sawm, Hajj, Khums, Zakat, Jihad, Al-Amr bil Ma'ruf, Al-Nahi al-Munkar. These legislations were already made by Allah. However, the Prophet and the Imams, they were given a limited authority to make certain changes, to make a few additions, to make a few subtractions. They have that authority. Some specifics were left to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They were allowed to make legislations in a few areas. Nothing major. Nothing major. However, some details were left to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Some details were left to the Imams to make. And here I will read you several ahadith from Al-Kafi. And some of these narrations have a sahih sanad. You have authentic chain of narrators. Some of them could be weak, but some of them are also authentic, verified by scholars of Rijal. So for example, in Al-Kafi, Sahih ibn Yasar. So this, the sanad of this hadith is authentic. عن أبي عبد الله he says إن الله عز وجل أدب نبيه فأحسن أدبه. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala disciplined his prophet and he perfected his discipline. فلما أكمل له الأدب, when he finished disciplining him, قال إنك لعلى خلق عظيم. And then ثم فوض إليه أمر الدين. فوض إليه أمر الدين. Allah delegated to the Prophet matters of religion. أَمْرَ الدِّينِ وَالْأُمَّةِ لِيُسَوِّسَ عِبَادَهِ. He gave him the matters of religion and the ummah to legislate as he sees fit. فَقَالَ عَزَّ وَجَلْ مَا آتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُوا. Allah says, what the Prophet gives you, take. What the Prophet forbids you from, stop. وَإِنَّ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ كان مسددا موفقا مؤيدا بروح القدس. Rasulullah was supported, and the legislated laws that he came up with, they were exactly what Allah had intended. They were exactly what Allah had desired. Rasulullah hit the mark when he legislated certain laws. It was exactly what Allah had desired from him, and Rasulullah hit the mark. لا يزل ولا يخطئ. Rasulullah never made a mistake. When he legislated, he never made a mistake. ولا يخطئ في شيء مما يسوس به الخلق فتأدب بآداب الله. Rasulullah never made a mistake. Why? Because he was disciplined with the discipline of Allah and had the etiquettes that were taught to him by Allah Azza wa Jal. طيب, this is one hadith. Another hadith also in Al-Kafi. عن أبي إسحاق النحوي قال دخلت على أبي عبد الله فسمعته يقول أن الله عز وجل أدب نبيه على محبته. Again, the Imam Sadiq is saying that Allah disciplined and perfected his prophet. فقال إنك لعلى خلق عظيم ثم فوض إليه. And then Allah delegated to the prophet. He delegated to him, meaning that you can legislate laws. He perfected him in such a way that he entrusted him with legislating laws. And then he says, فَقَالَ عَزَّ وَجَلْ مَا آتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُوا وَقَالْ مَنْ يُطِعَ الرَّسُولَ فَقَدْ أَطَاعَ اللَّهِ. Allah says in the Quran, Imam Sadiq says, that he who obeys the Prophet is as if he's obeying Allah. The obedience to the Prophet is obedience to Allah. Meaning what the Prophet gives you, take from him. He has the right to legislate. And then, and this is the important part, ثُمَّ وَإِنَّ نَبِيَّ اللَّهِ فَوَّضَ إِلَىٰ عَلِيٍّ وَأَئِمَّتِنَا. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had delegated to Rasulullah, Rasulullah delegated to whom? Ali ibn Abi Talib. and to the Imams. The authority of legislating laws that was given to him by Allah, he also gave to Imam Ali and the rest of the Imams. A third hadith. Basically, the same meaning, وَفَوَّضَ إِلَىٰ نَبِيِّهِ, and this is in Al-Kafi, عن أبي عبد الله, the hadith is by Abi Abdullah, وَفَوَّضَ إِلَىٰ نَبِيِّهِ, he delegated to his prophet, meaning he gave them the authority to legislate. فقال ما آتاكم الرسول فخذوه وما نهاكم عنه فانتهوا. And then the Imam says فما فوض إلى رسول الله فما فوض إلى رسول الله فقد فوضه إلينا. What Allah delegated to the Prophet, He delegated to us, meaning the Imams. So the right of legislation is not restricted just to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This right was given to Rasulullah, and Rasulullah in return gave it to whom? To the Imams of Ahlul Bayt. So what we understand from these verses, wa salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. What we understand from these traditions and from these narrations is that Allah disciplined His Prophet. He perfected him in a way that Rasulullah will only love that which Allah loves. He will only desire that which Allah desires. And so when he legislates in a way that if he hadn't legislated, Allah would have legislated. But Allah no longer needs to legislate because his prophet already legislated. Allah perfected and molded Rasulullah in such a perfect manner that he knows what Allah wants. He knows Allah's wants and desires. And hence he was given this authority of legislating. And hence Rasulullah gave this authority that was invested in him. He gave it to whom? He gave it to the Imams and to the Ahlul Bayt. Let me give you two examples and it will make this idea even more clear. But first I want to hear a very loud salawat. Imagine you have a business. You're a business owner. You've worked on a huge business. And you raised this business from zero, from scratch. And now you're growing older. Or you travel a lot. And you need someone to be in your position. Or you want to take a break. You want to relax. Your son is your protege. You've raised your son, you've disciplined him, you've taught him well, you've educated him, you've disciplined him, you've taught him the art of running a business. An excellent business. To the point that you know that your son will never do anything that you dislike, that you do not desire. He will do exactly like you need, exactly like you want. طيب. Now the son of yours, you go on a break for 2 weeks. Will you put your son in your position to run the business or not? Do you trust him or you don't trust him? You trust him. Why? Because you raised him. You disciplined him. You educated him. You are 100% sure that your son will not do anything that you don't desire. In fact, anything that he does in the business, he buys, he sells, he exports, he imports, it's all based on your desire. When you come back to the business, it's as if you did all of these things. But you didn't. Who did? Your son. And at the end of the day, when you delegated to your son and your son was running the business, at the end of the day, this all comes back to whom? The father or the son? The father. When the son performs these things, it's as if the father was. Because there's no two, it's not two people running the business. It's actually one person. One person who directly runs the business and the other who delegates and runs on behalf of the big boss. This is the first example. The second example, imagine a marji', a top marji', who is followed by millions of people. But now, he cannot follow all the intricate details of his followers, of taqleed, of all the masail, of running the entire marji'iyah, he delegates to whom? His son or his wakil. Whom? Who he has raised, he has disciplined, he has educated, he has perfected, so that he knows his son will not commit a single mistake. Or whatever he does, he's following his desire. The desire of whom? The marji', the father. He knows that his son won't do anything that will displease his father. Will he trust him or he doesn't trust him? He trusts him. He'll trust him with running the marji'iyah because he perfected him. He taught him. He educated him. He trusts him. He knows that his son will not go right and left. He will go straight and run the marji'iyah as if the father is running the marji'iyah. You see? It's the same. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I have perfected my Prophet and I've disciplined him, that means Rasulullah will not legislate anything that Allah does not desire or Allah doesn't want. He knows exactly what Allah wants and hence he will legislate it.
Salat wa Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Sayyidina, excuse me for a second. Please, with the parents with the young children, please kindly stay with them to make them quiet. I said they're disturbing the majlis. Kindly request all the parents to please keep with their children so we can have a proper majlis etiquette. Salawat for Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
Now you might ask, did Rasulullah legislate certain laws or is this just theoretic? Is just this a theoretic discussion or is there a practical discussion that Rasulullah did legislate certain things? I'll tell you, no, he did. We have a hadith that say Rasulullah legislated several matters. Several matters. So for example, in Sahihat Al-Fudayl ibn Yasar, Sami'tu Aba Abdullah alayhi salam yaqul, and this is hadith, it's a sahih sanad found in Al-Kafi on the authority of Imam al-Sadiq. He says, Inna Allah Azza wa Jal farada as-salata rak'atayn. We mentioned this last night as an appetizer. And we said we'll give the full discussion tomorrow night, which is tonight. Allah, when He prescribed the salah, the five daily prayers, each salah was two units. Five. And Allah farada as-salata rak'atayni rak'atayn. Ashara rak'at. The five daily prayers were actually 10 units. فَأَضَافَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ إِلَى الرَّكْعَتَيْنِ رَكْعَتَيْنِ. Rasulullah added 2 units to Dhuhr, 2 units to Asr, and 2 units to Isha. وَإِلَى الْمَغْرِبِ رَكْعَةً. And he added 1 unit to Salat al-Maghrib. فَأَجَازَ اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلَّهُ ذَلِكَ. So Allah approved of this. You see, Rasulullah legislated, Allah what? Signed off, so to speak. He approved of this legislation. فَصَارَتِ الْفَرِيضَةِ سَبْعَ عَشَرَةَ رَكْعَةً. And so, the fara'il became 17 units. 10 that were prescribed by Allah, and 7 were added by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. طيب. ثُمَّ سَنَّ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi النَّوَافِلِ 34 rak'ah. Rasulullah, he legislated 34 units of mustahab salah, as-sunan. An-nawafil. 2 units before salat al-subh. 8 units before dhuhr. 8 units before al-asr. 4 units after maghrib. And 2 units after isha. This was done by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This was legislated by Rasulullah. فَأَجَازَ اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلْ ذَلِكَ. Allah approved. This is what Imam Sadiq alayhi salam is saying. فَأَجَازَ اللَّهُ لَهُ ذَلِكَ. Allah approved of what Rasulullah legislated. طيب. And then the hadith goes on. وَفَرَضَ اللَّهُ فِي السَّنَةِ صَوْمَ شَهْرِ رَمَضَانِ. Allah prescribed the fasting of the month of Ramadan. وَسَنَّ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَعَلِهِ صَوْمَ شَعْبَانِ. The fasting of Ramadan was prescribed by Allah. The fasting of Sha'ban was prescribed by Rasulullah wa thalath ayyam fi kulli shahr, and 3 days of every month. It is recommended to fast 3 days of every month. Who legislated this? Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This was not legislated by Allah. This was legislated by Rasulullah, but approved by Allah azza wa jal. فأجاز الله عز وجل ذلك له. Allah approved for them. Approved that for him. طيب. And then the hadith goes on. وحرم الله عز وجل الخمر بعينها. Allah forbid wine. Allah made a ban, put a ban on wine. وحرم رسول الله المسكر من كل شراب. And Rasulullah put a ban on all intoxicants. Allah put a ban on wine. Rasulullah came and put a ban on all intoxicants. This was legislated to. This was an authority that he had to ban all intoxicants. فأجاز الله ذلك له. Allah approved of his legislation. طيب. And then the Imam, it's a long hadith, but in the end he says, فوافق أمر رسول الله أمر الله. رسول الله, his decision was compatible with the decision of whom? Allah Azza wa Jal. It's as if Allah wanted to legislate these laws, but he left it to whom? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You know, sometimes in Arabic we say bila tashbih. Sometimes when you're about to say something but someone else says it before you, it's as if they read your mind. It's the same thing. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to legislate a law, but Rasulullah legislates it. Not that Rasulullah is in competition with Allah, he's running to legislate. No. But because he knows what Allah wants. He knows the desires of Allah. And so he legislates on his own. Let us know the azama of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is the greatness of Rasulullah. Something that a lot of us don't know about this. فَوَافَقَ أَمْرُ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ أَمْرَ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ وَنَهْيُهُ نَهْيَ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ. And what anything that he forbid, it was compatible with the forbiddance of Allah عز وجل. Meaning Rasulullah knew exactly what Allah wanted from him. And he did it. وَوَجَبَ عَلَى الْعِبَادِ التَّسْلِيمُ لَهُ كَالتَّسْلِيمِ لِلَّهِ تَبَارَكُ وَتَعَالَى. It is mandatory upon the servant to submit to Rasulullah the same way they submit to Allah Azza wa Jal. Submission to Rasulullah. Yes. طيب. And another hadith. صلوا على محمد وعلى محمد. This hadith is also kafi, and the sanad is mu'tabar. It has a reliable chain of narrators. When the hadith is sahih, I'll tell you. And if it's weak, I'll also tell you. I will note it. مُعْتَبَرة إِسْحَاقِ بِنْ عَبَّارِ عَنْ أَبِي عَبْدِ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ. It's on the authority of Imam Sadiq. وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ عَزَّ وَجَلْ فَرَضَ الْفَرَائِضِ وَلَمْ يُقَسِّمْ لِلْجَدِّ شَيْئًا. When Allah made the laws, legislated the laws of inheritance, he didn't put a share for the grandfather. وَإِنَّ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ أَطْعَمَهُ السُّدُسِ. Ya Rasulullah put a share for grandfathers. One sixth of inheritance goes to the father. فَأَجَازَ اللَّهُ لَهُ ذَلِكَ. Allah approved of this decision. طيب. In another narration, this narration does not have an authentic chain of narrators. عن زرارة عن أبي جعفر. So this hadith is on the authority of Imam al-Baqir عليه السلام. He says, وضع رسول الله دية العين. Blood money for eyes. If you pluck out someone's eyes, or damage someone's eyes, or you make someone go blind, on purpose or by accident, there's a dia, there's a blood money. Who put that blood money? Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It was legislated by Rasulullah. وديه النفس, and the blood money for a human soul. وحرم النبيذ وكل مسكر. And Rasulullah forbade all intoxicants. The Quran only forbids what? Al-khamr. أنما الخمر والميسر والأنصاب والأزلام. The Quran only forbids wine, but Rasulullah came and forbade all intoxicants. طيب. And then one of the companions of Imam Sadiq, he says, وضع رسول الله من غير أن يكون جاء فيه شيء. Rasulullah legislated this law without any verse from the Holy Quran. Where did he get this? He said, نعم Yes, without anything revealed from Allah Azza wa Jal. There was no revelation regarding these things. Rasulullah legislated. Why? لِيَعْلَمَ مَنْ يُطِعَ الرَّسُولَ مِمَّا يَعْصِيهِ. Why? So that Allah discovers who obeys the Prophet and who disobeys the Prophet. This was a test. Do you obey Rasulullah or you don't obey Rasulullah? طيب. And another hadith. صَحِيحَةَ الْفُضَلَاءِ. So this hadith is sahih. It has an authentic chain of narrators. It's found in Al-Kafi. عن أبي جعفر وأبي أبي عبد الله. So both الإمام الباقر and الإمام الصادق. They say the hadith. قال فرض الله الزكاة مع الصلاة. Allah ordered zakat. He legislated zakat. He made zakat and salah wajib. وسنها رسول الله في تسعة أشياء. It is Rasulullah that made zakat in 9 matters. في الذهب والفضة in gold and silver. والإبل والبقر camels and cows والغنم and cattle والحنطة والشعير in استغفر الله بتقول I'm sorry grains like wheat and barley والتمر والزبيب وعفى عما سواها. It was Rasulullah that set the zakat in these 10 matters, in 9 matters. The actual zakat was legislated by Allah, but Allah delegated to Rasulullah to choose that zakat is wajib in what? Rasulullah chose that it will be wajib in these 9 matters. طيب. And another hadith, صحيحة زرارة. This is a repeat. عن عبد الله بن السنان. عن أبي عبد الله عليه السلام. أن الله لما أدب نبيه فانتدب ففوض إليه. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Rasulullah, he disciplined him, he perfected him. وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ حَرَّمَ مَكَّةِ. Allah made Mecca a haram, a sacred city, meaning you cannot pluck out the trees, you cannot kill insects. And Mecca, وَإِنَّ رَسُولَ اللَّهَ حَرَّمَ الْمَدِينَةِ. Rasulullah made Medina sacred. This was his legislated law. Rasulullah had the authority to make Medina sacred. فَأَجَازَ اللَّهُ لَهُ ذَلِكَ. Allah approved of his decision making and of his legislation. طيب صلوا على محمد وعلى محمد. We have two terms, my dear brothers and sisters. We have al-fariḍa and al-sunnah. What do we mean by al-fariḍa and sunnah? Usually, most people understand from al-fariḍa was sunnah. Fariḍa is that which is wajib, and sunnah that which is mustahab, correct? But ahadith tell us that there's another meaning for fariḍa and sunnah. Fariḍa is that which is legislated by Allah Azza wa Jal. Sunnah is that which is legislated by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is another meaning to al-fariḍa wa sunnah. So for example, in Sahihat al-Fudala, فرض الله الزكاة وسنها رسول الله. فرض الله سنها رسول الله. You see the dichotomy? When it's the legislation of Allah, this is called fariḍa. When it's the legislation of Rasulullah, this is called sunnah. And another hadith by Zurara, Sahih Zurara, فرض الله الصلاة وسن رسول الله عشرة أوجه. Allah made salah wajib. He legislated salah generally. But Rasulullah legislated other types of salah. Like what? Salat al-hadar wa safar. Shortening of salah. And which salah to be shortened? It was Rasulullah who decided. That any salah he added 2 units to, that salah will be what? Shorted in safar while traveling. And hence, dhuhr, asr, and isha. This salah will be shortened. وصلات الخوف على ثلاثة أوجه. This was legislated by Rasulullah. وصلاة الكسوف الشمس والقمر. This was legislated by Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. وصلاة العيدين وصلاة الاستسقاء والصلاة على الميت. All of these were legislated by Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. صلى على محمد وعلى محمد. So again, the narrations emphasize that Rasulullah didn't legislate out of personal whim, out of personal desire. For example, you woke up in the morning, today let us legislate, for example, 2 units for Salatul Dhuhr. Like that? Out of personal desire? No. But because Rasulullah was perfected, he was disciplined, and Allah gave him the knowledge of al-masalih wal-mafasid, meaning what is good, what is bad. What is good for the ummah, what is bad for the ummah. He had that knowledge, he carried this knowledge. And he carried the secrets of ahkam and the secrets of laws. Knowledge that not anyone else had. And hence he was able to legislate laws. So why, let's come back to the question, why would Allah delegate the legislation of ahkam to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Number one, to show his greatness. To show his greatness. Rasulullah was a great individual, to the point that Allah trusts him with his laws. You know, I remember in elementary school, even in high school, in middle school, one of the ways to build trust and confidence in students, when a teacher goes to the administration, or she goes to the restroom, or she chooses one of the students and tells them to stand and take over the classroom for the next 10 minutes, 20 minutes. Why? To show what a great person he is. That student, is he chosen randomly? No, the teacher will choose their best student, the student that they can rely on, the student that has studied the best. This student can take over the classroom for 10 minutes, 15 minutes. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he chooses Rasulullah and delegates the ahkam to him, he's trying to say that Rasulullah is the best of you. He's the best of Allah's creation. And I trust him with my ahkam. Two, because Allah wanted to test the mu'mineen. To test the mu'mineen. Allah says that if you want to obey me, obey Rasulullah. Whatever Rasulullah gives you, take it from him. There were some sahaba, they wouldn't accept from Rasulullah. You wouldn't. It's like on the day of Ghadir Khum, when Rasulullah appointed Amir al-Mu'mineen, Ali ibn Abi Talib, that man came, Al-Fihri, he came to Rasulullah, he told him, Ya Rasulullah, هذا منك أو من الله. Did Allah appoint Ali ibn Abi Talib, or is this from you? Does it make a difference? Does it make a difference? If it's whether it's from Allah or from Rasulullah, take it. ما آتاكم الرسول فخذوه. What is given to you by the Prophet, take it without question. Without question. Who are you to question Rasulullah? Even if it was from him, take it from him. Submit to him. Submit to Rasulullah. He said, if this is from you, then we will object. If it's from Allah, then may Allah curse me and send his wrath upon me. Immediately a rock fell from the sky. It hit his head and came out from behind. He fell. Khalas. سأل سائل بعذاب واقع للكافرين ليس له دافع من الله ذي المعارج. سورة سأل سائل بعذاب واقع. Thus Allah wanted to see who submits to Rasulullah, who obeys Rasulullah, who is a good servant. Because Allah wants us to worship the way He decides, not the way we decide. Some say, I only accept what is in the Quran. I don't accept a hadith. Who are you to decide? Are you a mu'min or are you not a mu'min? If you're a mu'min, you will accept the Quran and the hadith. It's not for you to decide and to choose what you want to accept and what you want to reject. That's not true faith. That's not true iman. True iman is to accept religion as a whole, whatever religion offers. Tayyib. The third theory says that only Rasulullah has the authority to legislate. The imams do not have the authority to legislate. And this is a theory held by some ulama. This third theory can be contested. How? Because we saw in the beginning several ahadith that says, وَإِنَّ نَبِيَ اللَّهِ فَوَّضَ إِلَىٰ عَلِيٍّ وَأَئِمَّتِنَا. Rasulullah, whatever was delegated to him, he delegated to whom? Ali ibn Abi Talib and to the Imams. And another hadith, فَمَا فَوَّضَ إِلَىٰ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ فَقَدْ فَوَّضَهُ إِلَيْنَا. all the authority that was delegated to Rasulullah, he delegated to the Imams and to the Ahlul Bayt. So if we accept these ahadith, we have to accept that the same way Rasulullah carried al-wilayah tashri'iyyah, the authority to legislate, so too that the Imams. Musalla ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, not to be taken lightly, the greatest human being. وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. Oh, you prophet, you have great manners. Great manners. فَبِمَا رَحْمَةٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ لِنْتَ لَهُمْ. It is with the mercy of Allah that you soften for them with your manners, with your akhlaq. وَلَوْ كُنْتَ فَضَّنْ غَلِيظَ الْقَلْبِ لَنْفَضُّوا مِنْ حَوْلِكَ. If you were harsh in your akhlaq, they would have all left you. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Rasulullah, with all the services that he did for this ummah, he had a special relationship to with his grandson Imam Hussein alayhi salam. One day, Ubay ibn Ka'b, one of the companions of Rasulullah, he says, we were walking with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the streets of Medina. All of a sudden he saw 3 or 4 year old Al-Hussein ibn Ali. When he saw him, he said, As-salamu alayka ya Aba Abdullah. Imagine, Imam Hussein is 3 years old. This is how Rasulullah would address him. As-salamu alayka ya Aba Abdullah. As-salamu alayka ya zinat as-samawati wal-aradheen. Peace be upon you, O the ornament of the skies and earth. So Ubay ibn Ka'b, he said, Ya Rasulullah, I thought you are zinat as-samawati wal-aradheen. I thought you were the ornament of the skies and the earth. He said, Ya Ubay, when I was taken up in Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj, when I reached a position in which even Jibra'il could no longer accompany me, ثُمَّ دَنَا فَتَدَلَّا فَكَانَ قَابَ قَوْسَيْنِ أَوْ أَدْنَا, I reached a position in which I saw the throne of Allah Azza wa Jal. I reached the throne of Allah Azza wa Jal. I saw written to the right side of the throne of Allah, Al-Husayn مصباح الهدى وسفينة النجاة. This is Imam Hussein alayhi salam. His name is written on the throne of Allah Azza wa Jal. That this ummah know who they were dealing with. That they know who were they forbidding from water. That the hooves of the horses know which chest they were trampling. It was the chest of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One day Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was in his house resting with Umm Salama. He had asked no one to come inside. Imam Hussein rushed in. Umm Salama tried to stop him. Rasulullah said, no, let him. He would come and he would sit on the chest of Rasulullah. Rasulullah would play with him. And then Jibra'il comes down. He says, Ya Rasulullah, tuhibbuh? Do you love him, Ya Rasulullah? Of course I love him. He would say, Husaynun minni wa ana min Husayn. Ahabba Allah man ahabba Husayna. Husayn is from me and I am from him. He told him, Inna ibnaka hadha maqtool. Your grandson will die. He will be killed. By who? Your own people, your own nation, they will slaughter him. Thirsty, alone, by himself, and here is some sand of the land where he will be killed and massacred. Rasulullah took the sand, he put it in a jar, and he told Salama that keep this in a jar. If it turns red, know that my son has been slaughtered. Another day, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was inside his masjid. He prolongs his sujood in Salatul Jama'ah. When he finishes his salah, his companions, they told him, Ya Rasulullah, asahot am nasit am nazala alayka al-wahi? Did you forget? Or did your mind wander? Or did Jibra'il come to you in the middle of sujood? He said, La hadha wa la dhak. Not this and not that. My son Hussein was on my back. I did not want to hurt him. This was the ummah. This was Rasulullah teaching the ummah the status of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. But what did this ummah do? I say, Ya Rasulullah, I wish you were there on the day of Ashura to see what they did to Imam Hussein alayhi salam. I wish you were there to see him lying in the sun, in the scorching sun, bruised, mutilated, hurt with spears and swords and rocks and arrows filling his body. Tens of arrows were in the body of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. His sister comes to him. His sister was in the tent, was in the cab. She started calling him, Ya Ibn Ummi, Ya Hussein. Oh, the son of my mother, Ya Habibi, Ya Hussein. Answer my call, my dear brother. In kunta hayyan fa adrikna. It is when the enemies attack the camp of Imam Hussein. They attack the women and children. They attack them. She said, "In kunta hayyan fadrikna." If you are alive, then come to our rescue. فهذه الخيل قد هجمت علينا. These horses are attacking us. These soldiers have reached our camp. Ya Aba Abdullah, come to our rescue, my dear brother. وَإِن كُنْتَ مَيِّتًا فَأَمْرُنَا وَأَمْرُكَ إِلَى اللَّهِ. And if you are dead, then we only have Allah to help us and rescue us. Sayyidat Zainab comes out in the middle of the day. She comes in the middle of the battlefield. When the arrows were coming down on Aba Abdullah, she comes to him, looking for him in the middle of the battleground within all of these mutilated bodies. She comes to the body of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, not recognizing him. She says, "Anta akhi, are you my brother? Anta ibn walidi, are you the son of my father? Anta himana. Anta rajana, are you our hope? Or are you our rescue?" Imam Hussein alayhi salam could not open his eyes. He could not speak. And then she said a word that she made Imam Hussein speak. She said, "Uqsimu alayka bi ummina az-Zahra." I swear by my mother Fatima, speak to me, my brother Hussein. Imam Hussein opens his eyes. He said, "My sister Zainab, you've broken my heart by mentioning the name of my mother Fatima. Go back to the tent. What are you doing in the middle of the battlefield?" After several hours, this was during midday on the day of Ashura, after several hours, Sayyidah Zainab comes back to the battleground on the night of the 11th of Muharram. She comes looking in the middle of the bodies, the headless bodies, the mutilated bodies, the bodies that were stripped of their armor. She finally finds the body of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. She comes, sits next to him, and then she puts her hands underneath what was remaining of the body of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. She says, "Allahumma inna hadha al-Hussein ibn Ali. Oh Allah, this is al-Hussein ibn Ali. Qurbanu nabiyika Muhammad. This is the sacrifice of your prophet Muhammad. Fataqabbaluhu bi ahsanil qabool. Oh Allah, accept the offering of your prophet Muhammad." Meaning Imam Hussein, if Ibrahim tried to offer his son Ismail, but he was not able to offer him, Rasulullah offered his grandson Hussein on the day of Ashura. وَفَدَيْنَاهُ بِذِبْحٍ عَظِيمٍ. This was the offer of Rasulullah. نَايِمْ أَخَيِّ شْلَوَنْ نَوْمَا يَا حَرِّ الشَّمِسْ غَيَّرِ رُسُومَا يَا رَيَتْ يَوْمِ قَبْلْ يَوْمَا. لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون. وسيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون. والعاقبة للمتقين. نسألك اللهم وندعوك بسمك العلي الأعظم الأعز الأجل الأكرم يا الله. اللهم لا تدع لنا ذنبا إلا غفرته، ولا هما إلا فرجته، ولا عيبا إلا سترته، ولا خوفا إلا آمنته، ولا رزقا إلا بسطته، ولا شملا إلا جمعته، ولا مرضا إلا شفيته، ولا غائبا إلا حفظته وأدنيته، ولا حاجة من حوائج الدنيا والآخرة لك فيها رضا ولنا فيها صلاح إلا قضيتها ويسرتها يا أرحم الراحمين. We have been requested to recite Surah Al-Fatiha for Sayyid Abdul Hassan Naqawi, Marziya Hassan Naqawi, Qudsiya Dost, Raziya Askar, Mir Askar Ali Radhawi, for the soul of these deceased and the soul of your deceased. Rahimallah man qara al-Fatiha ma'a salawat.
On that day of Ashura, from that land of Karbala, hal min nasir yansurana, hal min nasir yansurana, battered and surrounded by the likes of Shimro Khurmala, hal min nasir yansurana, hal min nasir yansurana, hurt and thirsty at his cry reaches everyone near and far, hal min nasir yansurana, hal min nasir yansurana, there is no Qasim Akbar on O Muhammad Abdullah, there is no Abbas Okhur, no Muslim Ibn Osija, hal min nasir yansurana, hal min nasir yansurana, hal min nasir yansurana, hal min nasir yansurana. We wish we were there to say labbayka ya ibn Rasulullah, we wish we could have responded to your call of Ashura, hal min nasir yansurana, hal min nasir yansurana, hal min nasir yansurana, min nasir yansurana. 1400 years it's been, still it feels like yesterday, your halmin still resonates in the minds of your Shia. Hal min nasir yansurana, hal min nasir yansurana, hal min nasir yansurana, hal min nasir yansurana. We will be your messengers, we will propagate your name, We will spread the light of justice through the power of your flame. If we want to be this way, if we wish to say Labaik, we must first begin to see, we must first begin to take. Every day as Ashura, every land as Karbala, Kullo yawmin Ashura, Kullo arzin Karbala. Every day as Ashura, every land as Karbala, Kullo yawmin Ashura, Kullo arzin Karbala. Hal min nasir yansurna, hal min nasir yansurna, hal min nasir yansurna, hal min nasir yansurna.
Hussein. The savior of Islam is Imam Hussein. The savior of Islam is Imam Hussein. Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein. The savior of Islam is Imam Hussein. Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein. The savior of Islam is Imam Hussein. Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein,
Ya Hussein.
Akbar and Asghar have been sacrificed. Qasim and Abbas have both been lost, defending the deen of Muhammad. You have sacrificed your house, Imam Hussein. Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein. The savior of Islam is Imam Hussein. Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein. The savior of Islam is Imam Hussein. Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein,
Ya Hussein,
Ya Hussein. Fatima Zahra continued weeping. They cut your throat despite your mother's crying. Atop the spear, your severed head kept calling. The call of truth and righteousness, Imam Hussein. Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein. The savior of Islam is Imam Hussein.
Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein. The savior of Islam is Imam Hussein. Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein.
The effect of your tragic death is felt today. The basis of your majlis was made in Sham. Bintul Ali sat upon the barren ground. There she taught the majlis of Imam Hussein. Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein. There she taught the majlis of Imam Hussein. Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein. The savior of Islam is Imam Hussein. Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein. Fatima Zahra has favored us, choosing us as your mourners. Your mourners received an honor. The wish of Fatima fulfilled, Imam Hussein. Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein. The wish of Fatima fulfilled, Imam Hussein.
Ya
Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein. The savior of Islam
is Imam Hussein. Imam Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein. The savior of Islam is Imam Hussein. Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein.
These majlises have been support for us whenever sadness has afflicted us, ridding ourselves of all tragedies. Humbly and faithfully we call Hussein. Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein. Humbly and faithfully we call Hussein.
Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein. The savior of Islam is
Imam Hussein. Imam Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein.
The savior of Islam is Imam Hussein. Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein,
Ya Hussein,
Ya Hussein,
Ya Hussein,
Ya Hussein,
Ya Hussein,
Ya Hussein,
Ya Hussein,
Hussein, Hussein, Hussein.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Assalamu alayka ya Rasulallah. السلام عليك يا علي أمير المؤمنين، السلام عليك يا فاطمة الزهراء.